scheduled to do, I told, so I'm sorry.
Oh, is he?
Sorry. I don't have anything prepared, but I do have some news that I want to share because the time has come that I am able. I'm engaged. Woo! I don't know, thank you. I don't know if all of you have met Kelly yet. She was here last Sunday. That's her name. So it's very exciting. You know, God has been very good to both of us, and we've been very blessed. You know, the time that we spent together and know each other. We know that we are not together by chance. This was something that He set in motion. So, very excited. I just wanted to share that with you because you're my family, and I want to share the good news. Other than that, God's good. Keep believing and trusting in Him. Any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? Yes, Meyer.
Yeah, I was having talked to my oldest son up in Duluth for a couple weeks, and the other, and I usually pray over my sons every morning, and I was praying for Matt, especially for favor with his new boss and stuff, and he called me the other night about a half an hour before I was going to call him, and he said that he had his 90-day review, and they used to give him a dollar raise, but there was some the management and his trainer, the other parts guy, got into it, I guess, and the manager got fired, and the trainer left, so Matt was kind of running the store, Kenworth. So he said the guy came up from St. Paul and said, you know, I've been watching you, and I guess his trainer came back, but the manager from St. Paul says, I've been watching what you're doing. He says, I know they promised you a dollar raise. He says, but I don't want to lowball you. He says, I think you've been doing a good job. He says, so I'm going to give you $3. I'm just like, I said to Pat, I said, you know what, buddy? I said, I've been praying for favor between you and your bosses. So, hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Thank you, Lord.
Got a text from Diana Tarpey reminding me, Joe and Diana are talking to him, that there's a gentleman named Zach Hockenberg. He's supposed to respond to Joe about a job situation. And Tim, do you know, he said that you know him, Zach Hockenberg?
When he come out there
he mentioned you and stuff, and said he knew you and stuff like that. But anyway, we just looked up Zach about a job situation that Joe's concerned about. He was supposed to respond 2 times and hasn't, but he didn't ask the crew to lift him up for his day because there's an alignment coming in. Joe wants to make sure it happens correctly. So.
Go to Oregon's boyfriend has been out of work for a while. He's applied all over. It's just a tiny little town in Eugene, but he really needs God's favor, and he's a door opening. Mm-hmm. Tell him to come home. There's all kinds of job openings here.
Tim.
Yes, I just want to thank the Lord for his favor and how he does things. You know, I mean, we don't take anything for granted. God opened the doors. Like, I was off Thursday, and I had to go to the doctor for a checkup, and I need to go to the dentist, and they're usually way out on their appointment. They were already in the May on their appointments. So I called them to set up an appointment, and they said, well, we got time today at 2 o'clock. And I just thought, wow, that was such an answer to prayer right there, you know. And I just thank the Lord for those things.
Yes.
I thank the Lord for my job with the students. When I see them get their license, like Friday, they came in and graduated. And to be with them through the whole thing and to see how grateful they were that we helped. And I told them from the day one, we're here to invest in you. And I really believe that's what God wants us to do with one another.
Yes.
I mean, that's just been the cry of my heart for a long time. That, you know, we never tell a person that there's no plan for your life. You always tell them there's a plan for your life. You know, God's got great things in store for them and encourage them.
Yes.
There's so many people out there need the encouragement.
Yes.
You know, and need to somebody believe in them. And that's what God does so well.
Yes.
You know, God doesn't give up on us. You know, he keeps bearing with us because he looks at not what we are now,
right,
just that point, what we can be in him.
Amen.
So I just want to thank the Lord for that.
Amen.
Yes.
Really good to me. He watched over me. I had my doctor's appointment, and everything was absolutely normal. She reminded me that 2 years ago there was a small spot on my lung, and I needed to go have that chest scan again. So just pray for me. I'm sure God's got my back.
Yeah.
He brought me through all those other issues.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
So,
I just want to thank everyone for praying for my brother, Kirby, who suffered a stroke. He had no strength on his right side, but now he's about 85%.
Let's come to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the blessings that you give us. We thank you, Lord, because you are good. We thank you, Father, for all the promises. We know that you have promised us prosperity, healing, Lord, deliverance. Father, we thank you. We cast all of our cares upon you, and we trust you, Lord. And we know that when we speak your word, every situation that we bring to you is finished. We ask, Lord, that you open doors that no man can close, job situations, Lord, that you provide for those that are seeking for provision, Lord. We know that you are the God of more than enough. We thank you, Father. Thank you for all of your blessings. We thank you, Lord. We come boldly to you because of Jesus. You gave your only Son, Lord, to die for us so that we could become your righteousness.
Spirit, have your way.
We thank you, Father. We thank you. Come to you now with all of these concerns, with all of these requests, Lord. We come to you with every care that we have in your hands. We know, Lord, that you're going to
depression.
So they can come, Lord, and come to you, Father, to know who you are. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Compassion. And the years and the weeks and the months of prayers being brought forth this day in this place. The river is flowing, church.
Every prayer that we say.
The gates were open almost 4 weeks ago. The gates were open to this city from this eastern side. The abundance of the river is flowing, church.
Thank you, Heavenly Father. Cast all of our cares upon you. We know that you restore what's broken.
We come to praise you, Lord. We come to praise you, Lord.
Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
Yes.
Do you have anything to add?
Yeah, the gates are getting open wider.
Lord's going to be here.
Yes. Praise the Lord.
That's right.
It's already here. Yes, Sally.
We're going to have a dinner on the 20th, and I'm saying Mexican because he never lets me have it.
Taco, burrito, enchilada. All right.
I'm trying to figure out how Palm Sunday and Mexican come together. It has nothing to do with my ethnicity. It has to do with my stomach. The pastor made an analogy of duct tape and religion once today. What was that phrase, Pastor?
Well, I just said that I believe that duct tape can fix anything. And if it can't, you just need more duct tape. So what the church seems to do a lot of times, what religion does is try to duct tape stuff instead of going to the source and actually fixing what it is.
Amen.
And only the Holy Spirit can do that.
Yes. That's right. Yes.
We'll bring some antacid for Pastor.
Yes.
All right, let's speak the word this morning. Will you now revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you.
demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but I am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Toby and John, would you mind taking the offering, please? Toby, could you say the blessing?
People need you, and your word declares that two or three gathered together, you're in the midst.
Yes.
So here today we call your spirit to join us, God, and we will give you great praise and glory for you are worthy.
Yes.
God, now we stand in your word, for it is always faithful and true, in all the needs that we have each and every day, God. Lord, now we just ask that you will bless this offering, bless the gift and the giver, in the mighty name of Jesus we pray.
Yes,
amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, I changed it. I just remembered. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Joy of the Lord is our strength.
Yes.
Good.
No, Tammy told me I'm having issues with losing hair. So she said
I can relate.
To start using castor oil on my head. So I've been using castor oil on my head, and he said he thinks it affected my mind.
Hallelujah. 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 Y'all ready to praise the Lord?
Worship in one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
Glory,
glory hallelujah.
Hallelujah
to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise. Worship in one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise. Worship in one accord. Every praise.
fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand. And he's riding a white horse across this land. He has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand. And he's riding a white horse all across this land. And he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me?
Been waiting 4 weeks to do this song, church.
He has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand. And he's riding a white horse across this land. And he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We'll ride with you.
Let's do that same verse again. He has fire. Thank you, Sheila.
He has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand. And he's riding a white horse across this land. And he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? We say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We will ride. We say, yes, Lord. We will stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. He has a crown on his head,
yes.
He carries a scepter in his hand, and he's leading the armies all across this land, and he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me, will you ride with me? And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Ride. We say, yes, Lord, we will ride with you. We will stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. We'll be dressed in white. For his bride, and he's longing that she be with him right by his side. That fire in his eyes is his burning desire, that his bride be with him right by his side. And he's calling out to us right now, will you ride with me? He has a crown on his head.
Sing it.
He carries a scepter in his hand, and he's leading the armies all across this land. And he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? Will you ride with me? And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We'll ride with you. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Sing it again, church.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Woo! 'Cause there's a blessed time that's coming, coming soon. Maybe evening, morning, or at noon. There'll be a wedding of the bride, united with the groom.
We shall see the King when he comes.
We shall see.
We shall see the King. We shall see the King. We shall see the King when he comes. He's coming. Blessed hour, we shall see the King when he comes.
Are you ready? Should the Savior call today? Would Jesus come and say, well, go away? He's building a home for the pure. The vile can never say, yes, Lord.
We shall see the King when he comes. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. We shall see the King when he comes. He's coming in power. He'll hail the blessed hour. We shall see the King when he comes.
When he left his spirit with us, and we accepted him in his to his loving arms. The grace and the mercy that he has poured out, the victory that he's already won.
Yes. Yes.
This is the blessed hour.
Yes.
We need to release the kingdom that is
right
within
now.
Us.
Yes.
We need to go forth with his kingdom.
Yes.
So, my brother, are you ready
yes.
for the call? Are you ready? We'll crown our Savior, King and Lord of all the kingdoms of this world. We'll soon.
We shall see the King when he comes. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. We shall see the King when he comes. He's coming in power. We'll hail the blessed hour. We shall see the King when he comes. We shall see the King. We shall see the King when he comes. He's coming in power. We'll hail the blessed hour. We shall see the King when he comes. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. We shall see the King when he comes. He's coming in power. We'll hear the blessed hour. We shall see the King when he comes.
He's coming in power. He's coming
in power. We'll hear the blessed hour. We shall see the King when he comes.
Because there's no one like you, Lord.
No, yes,
there's
Lord.
There's no one like you, Lord.
No one like you, Jesus.
You're beautiful, no Lord. Like you're you so beautiful, Lord.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Woo, King of your majesty. Love you, Lord. Show your people this day, Lord, how to release the kingdom that you placed within us, oh Lord.
Yes.
To reach out to this community, to this city, Lord. Because there's no one like you, Lord. Release your spirit, Lord. Woo.
There is no one, no one like you. Wonderful God, you are amazing. You created. The nations will hear of your name, and every knee will bow before you. We will sing to you. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Heaven and earth are filled. Heaven and earth are filled with exalted high, and the train of his robe it filled the temple, and the angels circled round him and cried.
Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. He's declared that because he is holy, we are holy. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your ministry, Lord, the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for lives that are being touched today. Hallelujah. Even as we receive it by faith, Lord, it is finished. In Jesus' name, whatever that need might be, whatever the battle, whatever the struggle, just receive the power of Almighty God. Hallelujah. Through the presence of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Nothing is impossible with God. And therefore, nothing is impossible for you. If you can believe, if you can believe, all things are possible. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Give the Lord a big hand this morning. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated, and the Sunday school kids can go downstairs if they haven't already. Thank you, worship team. Spectacular. It was great. Praise God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for the anointing on the on our worship team. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Yes, Peter.
While we're worshiping, I just love the Lord's sense of humor. He was saying that today we're going to have an autograph signing here at church today. He's going to be here to sign autographs because he's going to write his word on your heart.
Hallelujah. Woo! Praise God. Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I love the Melton Burl of Christianity. Praise the Lord. It's once you get it, it's yours. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, everybody, for being here this morning. God bless you. And Sheila, let's just get right into this. We're going to start. I've got a couple of places here I want to kind of work from, but let's begin with 2 Kings chapter 5, and we're going to go verses 1 through 14. I may stop in there at some point, but anywhere you get up there will be good. So 2 Kings chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm sure this is pretty familiar scripture to most of us, and but we'll read down through here. Now, Naaman, captain of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and honorable because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. He was also a mighty man in valor, but he was a leper. The Syrians, and let me just say this, in the typology of the Old Testament, leprosy is a type of sin. So just kind of keep that in mind. But the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. She said unto her mistress, "Would God my lord were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy." And one went in and told his lord, saying, "Thus and thus said the maid that is of the land of Israel." And the king of Syria said, Go, and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel. And he departed and took with him 10 talents of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold and 10 changes of raiment. He brought the letter to the king of Israel, saying, "Now when this letter is come unto thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman my servant to thee, that thou mayest recover him of his leprosy." And it came to pass, when the king of Israel read the letter, he rent his clothes and said, "Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man should send unto me to recover a man of his leprosy? Wherefore consider, I pray you, and see how he seeketh a quarrel against us." And it was so, when Elijah the man of God had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, "Wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Let him come now to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and with his chariots and stood at the door of the house of Elijah. And Elijah sent a messenger unto him, saying, "Go and wash in Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. Now, I'm going to stop here, so just a moment. But here, again, the metaphor is that God sends a messenger. The messenger, obviously, is the Holy Spirit. So this guy is covered in leprosy. He's a good guy. He's done some good stuff, but he's got leprosy. And so they send him to the, well, they don't send him to the king, but they send notice to the king, and the king freaks out because he knows he has no power to heal this guy, so he figures they're just trying to pick a fight. But the prophet finds out about it, and he tells the king, send him to me. And then the prophet sends the messenger. In this case, the metaphorically, we're talking about the Holy Spirit, goes out to this guy. All right, so Naaman was wroth and went away and said, behold, I thought he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hand over the place and recover the leper. Are not Arbana and Pharpar rivers of Damascus better than all the waters of Israel? May I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. And his servant came near and spake unto him and said, my father, if the prophet had bid thee do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather than when he saith to thee, wash and be clean? Then he went down and dipped himself seven times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God, and his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. So, the prophet sends a messenger, the Holy Spirit, which is a messenger of hope, to Naaman. Now, he feels like he needs to go to some big, notable, fancy, well-known church. Some great preacher should come out and lay hands on him and prophesy over him and do some big spectacular thing. But the messenger, the Holy Spirit, he just says, go down to that dirty little Jordan River and dip seven times. That no place. Go to that no one. Just hope in the message that was given by God. And then respond to it. And the Holy Spirit will bring healing. He'll bring deliverance. He will come. And Naaman is healed. And he's healed because he hoped in a promise. Praise the Lord. Now, if you will, Sheila, let's go to Romans chapter 4, and I want to read verses 13 through 18. For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect. Because the law worketh wrath, for where no law is, there is no transgression. Therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. Now, I don't know what your childhood was like, but mine was defined by rules. In my home, there was a long list of do's and don'ts. Some spoken, some unspoken. Some rational, and others totally irrational. But they were the rules. And I had, there were six of us kids, and we lived in a big house, an old, big old house. Five bedrooms and lots of space outside, but it only had one bathroom. That wasn't uncommon when I was a kid. It was normal, pretty much. But one of the rules we had was don't get up and go to the bathroom after you've gone to bed. Now, my brothers and I slept upstairs. We had, actually, there was 4 bedrooms upstairs and 2 bedrooms down, but one we didn't actually use for a bedroom, but sometimes we did, it just depended on how often we were fighting with each other. But nevertheless, we were told, you go to bed, you don't get up after you go to bed. And I thought that was kind of crazy, because what if I didn't have to go before I went to bed? Well, my dad would say, you should have anyhow. Hey, okay, you should have gone anyway. Well, my bedroom happened to be just above the living room. And in those days, we didn't have air conditioning. Not many people did, for that matter. I mean, if they did, it had a window unit, but we didn't have air conditioning. And so in the summertime, we'd open the windows, obviously, throughout the house. And my bedroom was right above the living room, and my dad would be there watching TV. So I had to go to the bathroom. I knew better than to go downstairs, because that's where the only bathroom was. So I peed out the window. Praise the Lord. The problem was, my dad's window downstairs in the living room was right below my window. So he heard it. And he thought it was raining, so he got up and went to the door and turned on the yard light and looked out, and he saw something coming down from above, but it wasn't rain. But it was coming from my bedroom. And the result was, just let me say, grace wasn't a dominant force in our family, praise the Lord. Rules were. Keeping score, good and bad. I'm not saying this to be hateful to my parents. They were great people. But that's the way it was back then. There were rules, and you went by the rules. So I broke the rules. So I kept score. I had been bad. I wasn't good. Amen? And another thing I was thinking of the other night, I was putting some notes together. When I was a kid and we went to Sunday school, we went to a very nominal type of church. It was, you know, I mean, they talked about Jesus, but they really didn't have a salvation message or anything. But they always had a scoreboard up at the front of the church. Praise the Lord, I called it a scoreboard. And it was up there for everybody to see. It was a wooden board, and hung on the wall, and it had little slots in it so they could insert these numbers into those slots. And you could see what the attendance was for last Sunday, for this Sunday, and for Sunday a year ago. They would show every week it was there. Now, I'm sure that those numbers were displayed for the best of reasons, but it was really about you keeping rules and being there. And the church keeping score. Romans chapter 12, verse 2, Sheila. Today I would have been arrested for exposure. Except we didn't have any neighbors across the street. There was just a pasture over there. And I don't think the cows ever recognized, because they were doing it all the time. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Amen? Transformed. Now, you know, something I've discovered over the years is that every age has had the ability and actually has produced fairy tales. Now, as humans, we've actually been designed with a natural attraction for fairy tales. Little girls dream of becoming princesses, queens. Little boys dream of being war heroes and cowboys and firemen. There's something about fairy tales that just never grows old. My grandkids, when they come over, you can read the same story over and over and over. And yet every time it's like the first time. Yeah. Even though they can tell it from memory. Yeah. Well, they don't know how to read, but they can tell me what I'm going to say before I ever say it, because they've heard it so many times. But it's still, they get all excited about it. Yeah. There's still something exciting about having that fairy tale read to him. But at some point along the process of growing up, those worn out, beat up, dog-eared books get put away in the basement or in the attic, and reading fairy tales becomes a thing of the past. Now, we might have outgrown reading fairy tales, but not our attraction to fairy tales, because the basis of every fairy tale is hope. A good fairy tale pulls back the curtain on reality. A frog doesn't have to stay a frog. He can become a prince. Cinderella doesn't have to remain a servant in poverty. She can become a princess. A leper can be healed. A naughty boy peeing out the window can become a preacher. An absentee churchgoer can change the score and become a winner. Fairy tales show us the possibilities for transformation. They're filled with hope. They're filled with greater things to come. Life as we know it doesn't have to stay the same. People everywhere crave hope. They long for it. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Jesus said, in this world you're going to have trouble. Amen. You've got health issues. You have financial issues. We have relational issues, inner turmoil, and struggles with our own selves. But in all of them, there's Jesus. Be of good cheer. I've overcome. He reminds us that greater things are coming. Better things are coming. And our hope in Jesus, our hope in Christ, should change the way that we face life. Yes. Hosea chapter 1, verse 1 through 3. Chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Word of the Lord that came unto Hosea, the son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, king of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. The beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea. And the Lord said to Hosea, go take unto thee a wife of whoredoms and children of whoredoms, for the land hath committed great whoredom, departing from the Lord. So he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim, which conceived and bare him a son. So God says to this man, he says, go find yourself a prostitute by the name of Gomer and marry her. Now that's asking a lot. Yeah. I mean, her name is Gomer. Yeah. But he does it. Praise the Lord. And after a while, he actually falls in love with this woman. But she goes back to prostituting. And God tells him to go find her. Bring her back and show your love to her again. Now, Hosea asked the question that almost anybody would have asked, and that is, why? And God says, so that the people will know and understand just how much I love them. Now, here's what's interesting. Most of us identify ourselves with the wrong characters in the Bible. And so we think, well, we read Bible stories and then we say, I'm going to obey God. It's a hard thing. It's difficult, but I'm going to do this. I'm going to go do whatever he tells me to do, no matter how difficult, no matter how much it goes against my natural way of thinking, but I'm going to just go do this. And so we think we're Hosea. And here's the bad news, or the good news, depending on how you look at it. We are Gomer. We aren't the rescuer, we are the rescued. We aren't the redeemer, we're the redeemed. We aren't the lover, we are the loved. We are the failures. We are the ones that get delivered and go back to what we got delivered from. Praise the Lord. God loves us with an "I will go to the whorehouse and buy them back for their sake" kind of love. And anybody who doesn't realize that is living without hope. That gives me hope. Praise the Lord. Hebrews 11, verses 1 through 3. I want people that are in this little, nondescript, nowhere, no great preacher to know, hope does spring eternal in the human heart because of Jesus, because of God. It's never over. It's never over as long as we have hope in Jesus. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Now, I know that life isn't a fairy tale. I've lived long enough to understand that. But if you read on, it'll tell you, and I'll just paraphrase, but by faith Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Sarah, Jacob, Moses, Rahab, Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, the prophets, Naaman, received righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life. Yes. Praise the Lord. Yes. Now, you know, really, you only need to add a few words to this whole thing to officially make it a fairy tale. And they all lived happily ever after. Yes. Praise the Lord. As Christians, we don't have to settle for a temporary hope. Something that promises but doesn't fulfill. We don't have to settle for a shallow hope or a false hope. We have an eternal hope, a hope that promises that something greater is going to come. No matter where you're at today, no matter what you're going through today, something better is coming. Praise God. That's what makes Christianity distinct from every other religion in the world. We don't have to put our hope in a belief system or a list of rules or in our own feeble attempts at morality and good behavior. Our hope isn't in a thing. Our hope is in a person. And his name is Jesus. Praise God. So frogs can still become princes. Servants can become kings. Peers can be pastors. Sinners become saints. And we will all live happily ever after for eternity. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Some of you were hoping that you'd get out of here early today. You need to praise the Lord. Because hope is real. And you're dismissed in Jesus' name. God bless all of you. Keep the hope, hallelujah, because by it faith manifests in every area of life. God bless you in Jesus' name. First one at the Golden Corral. First one at the buffet today. Praise the Lord.